Okay. Home stretch. So we're going to spend the most of the rest of the time talking about this catching butterflies concept, and I'm going to go back to the resident with the hair on fire stat palliative care consult case that we started with, because that turns out was a catching butterfly story. So I was part of the palliative care team. I wasn't a real palliative care doc, but I played one on TV. While we were getting the team started, I played the role, thankfully working next to a real palliative care advanced practice nurse until we recruited a real palliative care doc. So anyway, we went into Mrs. Johnson's room, and she was this kind of moaning, elderly, otherwise not responsive woman, and the daughter was sitting at her bedside like this. And so we introduced ourselves, we're palliative care, we explained what palliative care is, and the daughter said, well, it's about time, because I've been saying for days, my mom looks like she's in pain, can't somebody do something about it? So we said, yes, we will do something, we're gonna do it right this minute, and we gave her a little dose of something, and she calmed down, appeared more comfortable, and then we turned to Ms. Johnson's daughter and said, you know, we'd like to have a conversation with Ms. Johnson to get to know who she is, but we can't, so can we have that conversation with you? And she said, sure. So we asked, can you please tell us about Ms. Johnson as a person? And she told us this amazing story about her mom, who had raised her 9 kids, emphasizing the role for education for all of them, even though she herself had never finished high school. But then once the final kid had left home, when Ms. Johnson was in her 50s, she went back and got a high school degree, and then got a college degree, and then got a master's degree, and at age 60-something began to teach kids with learning disabilities and illiterate adults how to read. She did that for the next 15 years of her life until she had her first major stroke, which was a bad one. She was hospitalized and rehabbed for 3 months or so, but ultimately was well enough to walk out of the rehab facility. And at the desk, as she was exiting the rehab unit, she stopped and said thank you to everyone, and then said, and I pray to God I never see any of you again. And she gets home, and 2 days later, she had her next stroke. And from that point on, it was the revolving door of hospital to SNF to rehab to long-term care, and she never got home again. And this hospitalization was her 5th or 6th stroke. So hearing Ms. Johnson's daughter saying this, and knowing what our job as the consultants are, get them to be realistic about goals of care, what we did was catch the butterfly of her description of her mom and hold it up to her and say, so for anyone, losing your ability to communicate, losing your ability to think, losing your ability to read would be pretty devastating, but we would imagine for your mom, for whom thinking and learning and reading was so central to her life, that would be even a bigger tragedy. And her daughter said, it's the worst nightmare imaginable. So from there, the conversation into, well, now her kidneys are failing and we have these decisions, what do we think makes sense? There was no controversy. She chose a palliative approach and comfort And it was because, you know, we had a conversation and we used the words, her words from the conversation that described her mom and her values to help her make the decision that she needed to make. So that's just, I think, an example of what this butterfly catching technique is about. And we think that certain questions from the game are particularly well suited for certain types of conversations that you guys need to have regularly. Well, first, the two stories that I told already, and it relates to Ms. Johnson too. So question 11, the three things question, I think if you're needing to have a real end-of-life conversation with a patient about code status, that asking question 11, knowing what the likely responses are going to be, they're likely to include something about their identity, something about a personal attribute, something about a favorite activity. You can craft a way of holding those responses, or at least one of those responses, up and have that get into the DNR conversation that you need to have. So if they say, you know, he was a steel mill worker, so, you know, knowing what it took for him to be a good steel mill worker and knowing where he is in the course of his illness, what do you think makes sense in terms of, you know, the care options that we have going forward? Or, you know, she was a great mom, how could you be a great daughter to her, knowing now where she is in the course of her illness? So, for the heart failure patients that I described, or other people that are further upstream where you need to have more of an advanced care planning, goals of care conversation, I think fears and hopes modified to fit your circumstances can work really well, with the idea that after you hear what their fears and hopes responses are, you can say something like, my mom taught me that you should hope for the best but prepare for the worst. And so I just heard you describe kind of your best case, your hopes, and if those things happen, then there's not much planning that we need to do, because you've just told me what you're hoping for is your life gets back to normal or your disease gets put under control, whatever their response really was. But you just also told me what you're fearful of. And if any of those things happen, that seems like something that maybe we're currently not as well prepared for as we could be. And what could we do to prepare for if any of those fears actually comes to be true? So that's a way that either of those could be useful for those kind of conversation purposes. Getting back to the clinical archetypes that we talked about, if you've got a situation where the patient isn't staring at death in the face like you are as a clinician, then I think, and knowing the different pathways for getting into their situation, there are a few questions that I think could be useful. So for the cancer patient who probably has at least been thinking about death episodically throughout the course of their illness, one of the questions, this number doesn't jive with what's in your booklet, but it's in your booklet with a different number now, could be useful. When you think about care at the end of your life, do you worry more about not getting enough care, getting overly aggressive care, or something else? Asking a patient with progressive cancer patient that question could get them focused on what really is looming for them, and then build a bridge into, you know, you giving more bad news or planning for their progressive illness and what kind of care is delivered. The organ failure patient, however, who may not really have been thinking about their own potential mortality at all, I think this question, if you had 3 months to live, what would you give yourself permission to do? And then choosing something for each of those 3 months, that might get them to step back and say, wow, I hadn't ever really thought about the possibility that I had 3 months to live, but now, at least for the purpose of answering this question, I will, and that might build a bridge into the further conversation about, well, you know, might it be wise to do at least month one of these things now? And then for the frailty dementia patient, recognizing that many of the people are cognitively challenged and you may not be able to have conversations with them, it might be a family member, but you know, if they're so unconcerned, unfocused on their own end of life that it's being avoided, any decision making related to it, asking a question like this about controlling one thing about the place where you spend your last hours of life, what would that be? That's a way of, again, linking their current situation with the clinical outcome that you foresee happening sooner rather than later for them. And we know that as opposed to what happens when no conversations take place and the technology-laden deaths that too often people experience, that when we have these conversations, people die more comfortably and a much greater likelihood that the things that they have expressed as their own preferences regarding care is actually how care gets rendered. I'm going to actually save questions until we get to the end of the next section, okay? So one last concept that I want to share with you. This is something that I've recently written about, and we can provide a link to this paper. The paper I wrote was a little perspectives piece in response to an article that was written by a bunch of clinicians about what they refer to as multi-morbidity. And the premise is that a patient gets afflicted by some underlying chronic condition. And that underlying chronic condition or multiple chronic conditions starts to do its damage internally down to the cellular and humoral level. But then on top of whatever the diseases are doing to the person, on top of that comes stress, depression, pain, anxiety, concerns about finances, all of that stuff, which gets wrapped up in the pathologic process of the underlying illness and magnifies it and intensifies it and creates kind of a vicious cycle, internal cascade. So the paper that I wrote said, yes, that's true. The people that we've been talking about today with advancing serious illness, all have multi-morbidity. And I think that we can think about their experience with the disease as not just pertaining to themselves, they're the inner circle here, but also pertaining to the cascading network of relationships that are connected to them and then connected at another level beyond them, so that the multimorbidity that they're experiencing is also felt by the team of people providing direct care to them, particularly the family caregiver, that they're feeling stress and anxiety and pain and harm. And the organizations in which the patients work and the caregivers work are harmed, and that in the absence of communication, which is the red part of this curve, that multimorbidity is magnified dramatically. So patient stress, caregiver stress, work productivity declines due to absenteeism or functional absenteeism. But then on the green side of the curve, when conversations happen, I coined the term for that multi-beneficence, because inside, in the patient, once the conversations begin to happen, the stress and pain and anxiety is dampened down. So they've got a more comfortable experience of living with their progressive illness. And the family caregiver role gets dramatically improved. When the patient dies, the grieving process is dramatically improved. And ultimately, you can imagine the benefits to the organizations and society in which this all happens. And so I call that kind of a scale-free, multi-beneficial impact of communication. So less stress on the patient, a happier caregiver, and more productivity at work. This statistic pertains to one aspect of the work that I haven't spoken about, but it's basically what we did together for an hour. A group who are researchers from Penn State Hershey have studied groups like us who have played this game for 45 minutes or longer, and what happens to them when they go home. And it turns out that unprompted, 78% of participants in an hour of gameplay do one or more advanced care planning actions on their own. You may have already done them, I don't know, but Not yet. They're not double blind, but there is a randomized controlled trial that is being proposed at the NIH. Didn't make it through the most recent cut of funded studies, but it's been replicated with multiple groups, well people, like presumably most of us are here, people with chronic illnesses, strangers, people who are close families or friends. But we're looking to do an RCT, but it hasn't happened yet. I think there is power in just bringing people together and enabling them through the use of a tool like this to have conversations with each other that most people appear to be activated in some way coming out of an experience like that. I've been told to share that Blue Shield of Minnesota recently had a number of people undergo training in holding events, workshops, using this tool, and are likely to be doing that within the next few weeks, perhaps in your communities, perhaps coupled with National Healthcare Decisions Day. So if you hear anything about Blue Shield, Blue Cross of Minnesota, and this game, it's legit. And if you feel like supporting it, that's great too. So even though I just said that almost everybody would feel activated in some way to do something, at least around their own advanced care planning coming out of this, gonna provide a little nudge in doing something, not around your own advanced care planning necessary, but around your own conversation. So wanna do one more table activity. And let me tee this up for you. So this is called 1-2-4 or 1-2-table all. The way it works is when I finish giving the instructions, you're gonna write down your response to this question. Given what we've experienced this afternoon, an idea I have about how I can improve conversations for my patients, or if you're not in a role where you have patients, you can fill in the blank with family or organization or community is, and then write your idea down. So you'll take a minute to do that, then we'll have a paired conversation at your table, and then the entire table. Maybe for the, well, it's fine. For those of you that are at smaller tables, you'll just go from your one to the table as a whole. And at the end of that table conversation, we'll have a report out. When we do the report out, we're going to ask for some representative from the table to be the reporter. So think about that as you're having the conversation, who's going to be your reporter. And the job of the reporter will be to share not everything that you talked about, but particularly the one best thing that you heard. And since we're going to be doing the report out one table at a time, it's also the job of the reporter to share something that we haven't already heard. And if everything's already been covered, then you can just say everything's already been covered, okay? So while you're having your table conversation, try and notice any similarities that seem to be emerging from these ideas that have come up, and just talk about that in your conversation. Any questions about the setup for this activity? I will ring the bell when it's time to first join your paired conversation and then go into the table conversation. So first take your minute and write down your idea. 1 minute. Sometimes people think a minute is much shorter than they thought, and sometimes it feels a lot longer. Okay, that was a minute. So now form pairs, or if you're an odd number, form a group of three. Okay, if you haven't left your pairs to start your table conversation, start your table conversation now. We'll start in that corner. We'll go snake-wise like this, okay? So you'll come down that way. All right, and Jess is gonna be our scribe, just so that we have an archive of your ideas, and we will disseminate them back to you guys the collected wisdom of the group in terms of ideas.
All right.
That you have.
Spokesperson All right. at this table, best.
So share a
best idea.
Best idea.
One best. What? It was your thing. Okay, Peggy.
So I'm a social worker in a nursing home, and one of the things that I want to use is the whole catching butterfly thing, or I want to ask those questions of, don't tell me, I mean, I want to know how we should take care of your loved one. I want to know what the disease they have is and whatever, but I also want to know, you know, what did they like to do, or they went to school when they were 50 years old and they got their master's degree. And then I want to share that with the floor staff, so that they're aware of who they were before they came to us and they're really sick.
Nice. Great.
Good. Great. Catching butterflies and share the info.
I actually
use
the same phrase in here, though. Slow things down, ask the question to catch the butterflies, and get to know the person and the family as well as the patient and who they are.
Great.
Catching butterflies times two.
Just briefly stating, as a eco-feminist, as I call myself, organics is not one idea. So our best idea is not one thing. But starting from the place of hopes and fears, that there are those two dynamics that really resonated for us, like that coin flip. There's two places we can go. One active step is to have the nursing support to make the space for the nurses to have this experience of the conversation, so they're less fearful of pursuing it with patients. Another component of that was envisioning the conversation around a table that we physically work to change the space that we put our patients in, that we don't have them facing a wall or facing a TV. So turning off the TV or providing that space. And I think interspersed there too is to invite the conversation to whether or not people have the space and capacity for it, so it doesn't feel like something that it's being forced onto them.
Very cool. Thank you. All right. Moving down, we're going this way, this table here. Spokesperson Bonnie.
We talked about a similar thing, about making sure that our peers, from the physician side all the way to other nurses, have the equipment that they need to be able to ask the questions and feel comfortable with it, maybe getting them some tools. But the other thing we talked about a lot of things, but the other thing that was really good was talking about the nurses having some availability in a long admission, like with hospice, to actually still find out what are those three things that matter or things about them, instead of relying just on the social workers to do that.
Very good. Small patterns, iterating. Okay. Oh, a volunteer.
Ours probably kind of go along with everybody else's ideas, but we really appreciated the presentation and having questions to ask. And especially in certain situations. And so what our consensus was is that we're going to use those questions to elicit values at all through the hospice experience, whatever is, you know, most pertinent at the time.
All right, thank you.
Our group thought that we might pull those five things forward in our conversations.
Great.
While we were thinking about how to move this upstream and have the conversation before people get to the hospital or in dire straits, we also, as all the rest of you did, like the three-thing idea, although I was a little reluctant, we were a little reluctant to say, what are three things, which could be off-putting, but to say something like, can you tell me something important about yourself or your family member that might help us give you the better care. So instead of saying, give us three things, bang, 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 you know, a little bit softer.
Pace before you lead.
Time out for 1 second. The staff that introduced that question in this hospice unit environment, they came up with, I think, an interesting way of framing the asking of the question. First, they said, I have a question that I want to ask you that may sound strange, and normalizing it. We ask this of all patients, and again, normalizing it, we have asked and answered the questions for ourselves, and they actually have little like name cards that have their own question 11 responses on it facing outward to the, so just a way of trying to have it feel as comfortable as possible.
Very cool. Oh, that's you, I guess so.
We talked about a couple things at our table, but the one, when my son was going to third grade, his teacher had a deck of cards that said, like, getting to know you questions, so he had to choose one, so it was a way of the teacher to get to know him. So we really like the idea of having the cards. And now that you just said that idea, we're like, we could make those and put them on the back of our name tag so that our responses could be available for the patients to see. And it's just a way to get to know your patients and help develop trust and establish that rapport going forward. But the other thing that we said was we like the idea of putting those three things about the patient and posting them in the home, because a lot of times the patients feel like they have lost value in themselves and they're really just a burden to their family, and this helps re-identify some of those things about the patient that we all know, or we don't know, we're getting to know.
Very cool.
And Dan, this is the size of the
cards
that have the three things on it, so.
Okay, I think we'll do a doom, 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 doom here. So how about this table? You're it.
The winner at this table, yeah. I had the least amount of chips at this table, so oh. I'm the spokesperson.
Winner.
How do you figure that? No, anyway, I volunteer to teach classes for advanced care planning, and I thought that the booklet with the questions that we got, I could introduce in those classes, because we have a guide that we use, but it's those feared questions that are in the guide that you have to talk to your healthcare agent about. And so this seems just more relaxing and easier to use and whatnot. So thought that would be a good thing to do.
Great. This table. Oh Krista.
So we talked about how advanced care directives don't get filled out until the last minute, often because people don't understand the terminology or they're worried about not understanding it, and it just gets put off and it's not really a pleasant experience. So we talked about cultivating a time, a space, an experience, a gathering where questions could be answered. So us medical professionals who work in this area can answer questions in a safe space, maybe even gathering friends and family at home, to sit down with the advanced directives and start it and just simply do it together, and just to have that space. And then also talked about teaching classes in community education, and so just kind of using social networking and friends and family to gather and create that safe space.
Much of it's been said already, but we went at it from the standpoint of even experiences that start in the emergency room or admission to the hospital, that inverting the history taking and starting with these personal questions would color the rest of the information that you gather from the patient.
Great, thanks.
Our table said that we're going to listen more and talk less and maybe cue into things that the patients or the family say to help introduce the subject of end-of-life decisions, and maybe even asking a little bit more about what previous experiences they've had with death or hospice
that may be coloring their ability to make decisions right now.
We talked about, I think the most significant part is that these are much easier conversations to have around a table of people who get this. And it's probably a whole different story with a family who has a history of dysfunction and the fun associated with that. And that, I think the other thing about this is that having a trained facilitator, and as palliative care and hospice people, we need to move that upstream to primary care clinics and to primary care providers and teach them these kind of non-threatening skills that can allow them to engage these conversations, because it needs to happen on a much bigger scale than what we're going to be able to provide. And it's the stories, isn't it, the stories that we experience with our patients that enrich the work that we do and make us come back to work the next day. So,
Dan, one comment that... There's one organization, Mercy, the Mercy System in St. Louis, which has a real physician zealot around the use of this tool set. And they have put literally hundreds of games throughout their system. And sometimes they use them for those dysfunctional families that you talked about, like in the ICU, we need to have a conversation about X. The family's not talking with each other at all. Let's pull this out and have us play a question with them as a game to at least get them to start talking with each other. And then let's move from that into the conversation we need to have with them. They haven't written this up in any way, but they keep buying lots of these games too. So they're finding it successful in some way. So.
Are you the designated person?
I am. I think at our table we talked, most everybody said the emphasis was on non-medical questions. And we have to remember that. And the way that we're going to remember it is your vision of catching butterflies. But then we're going to go into another vision. And it's going to be more holistic. It's going to include the family. It's going to also involve barriers with our coworkers. That it was brought up that we should ask, well, how are you experiencing this person when you interact with them? Because a lot of times... The clinicians themselves will have different responses. So sharing that among one another, the non-medical questions, is really important for the for the clinicians themselves. And so it's breaking barriers by doing that. And then the resource of the five questions that, you know, forgive me, those kinds of, well, that was also mentioned. And then, so your vision of the butterflies leads into another vision, which is the vision that the patient would want. And if the patient's not able to speak, then it'll be the vision of the family. And the most important thing was for our table too, was to post that picture or that vision of that person when they were whole and healthy, so that everyone remembers. The remembrance is important. And I think for me, I'm going to try to take this to the Minneapolis Twin Cities has a parish nurse network where people with temples and mosques and churches, so that the conversation occurs outside of the care center and it has a spiritual basis. So I'm going to share that.
Great.
Thank you. Who's the designated DD here?
We talked about short stays in hospice and using some of these questions to kind of get to the heart of what matters to the family and the patient. With a few days left, you know, our system, we're really good about answering our assessment questions related to systems and our regulatory requirements, but those things don't matter. You know, with a couple days of hospice work left or a couple days of life left, it really doesn't matter they were using a walker or a wheelchair before they came in. These questions are more important.
Great.
Yeah.
I didn't bring this up, but I got to thinking about it as we were going along. And one of the questions I like is, what makes you lose track of time? because I think so many times we're looking at these people and trying to figure out what to do now. But maybe if we thought about what made them lose track of time, we might know what they enjoy and what maybe would get them away from where they are right now for a few minutes.
That's a great observation.
Okay.
I'm a nurse practitioner within a primary care clinic at a critical access hospital. I'm a part of the Mayo system, and we're one of the test sites for trying to introduce more advanced care planning into our primary care. Trying to start those conversations before we're the care provider in the ER dealing with this, and we know our patients because we're smaller, so we can do this. But when we were talking about the limitations is this makes us no money. We're primary care. We already lose money. We're not surgical. And there's no time. But I know that there's the code that you can bill for advanced care planning, and I think instead of... We try to get the skeletal bones, like your code status and what's important to you, and we try to put that in a single repository for their wishes. But I think instead of, like, your diabetes looks good, your COPD is okay, your platelets with your leukemia are hanging out steady, we're good for a year, I'm more using this booklet to bring them back and dive into things deeper.
Yeah, and I think that if you approach the conversation as though you could ask any question, the fear of how long is it going to take is very real. When you take a little bit of control by structuring it with, you know, I'm going to use this question to get into this particular conversation goal that I have, and here's the anticipated responses that, you know, I'm likely to get based on having tried it with previous patients, I think it can be a much more manageable kind of conversation.
But I agree, you should be starting in primary care.
Yes.
They trust us the most. That's why they
starting in primary care makes total sense.
Do you want to repeat that so we record it?
Sorry, I was going to say I just agree that it should start in primary care, and more PCPs need to be comfortable with it because your patients trust you for a reason and you can open the door a lot for them.
We just talked about, too, how this is such a normal conversation for us to have and, you know, really getting to know the person rather than their disease or even talking about, you know, what they want for their care. We actually use the example of, like, passing meds in the nursing home or the hospital. So many people, you know, we walk in, here's your meds. No thanks. You know, we don't walk into the room with that immediate hospice admission going, so do you want to be intubated? You know, we want to let them get to know us and get to know, you know, them before we have some of those deeper conversations.
We talked about using this booklet with our staff, maybe trying to get to know each other better and get them comfortable having these kind of conversations. And we also liked the three non-medical things to know about you, including that as part of our admission so that the team gets to know the patient and especially our volunteers so that they have something they can relate to with the patient. And personally, I'm going to take this book to my next family dinner and ask some tough questions.
Hi. We talked mostly about how to formally integrate this into hospital patient care, either getting it into the Epic or other EMR so that it's automatically comes up as a question or as a pre-work for a family care conference, like give the questions the day before and bring them up. We were also supposed to say something we hadn't heard before, and we had mentioned someone at our table has a talk every Thanksgiving with their family. They've been doing it for years, so we were trying to figure out how to institute that when people would rather be watching football. So we thought of turning it into a drinking game. And that would also, that would get the younger age groups more involved as well. So that's our plan.
Very creative. Drinking.
I'm sorry to say we cannot top that one. But, however, we were the loud laughter table over here. We have several admission people at our table, and I'm an ancillary person, and we kind of made a connection between those using those three archetypes of trajectory of disease. For me, I'm a music therapist, and a light bulb went on, you know, the cancer trajectory are those people that want help with anxiety and their symptoms and planning their funerals and things like that. The COPD-er types, or those organ failure types, are the ones who, they're not ready for that yet. And then when they are ready for it, it's too late. And then, of course, the people who are on the cognitive decline and frailty decline, they're the people who, it's kind of a no-brainer for some of the ancillary services, because their loved ones want best quality of life for them, and it's a thing that connects them back to who they were. So we kind of had a light bulb go on over here for that. And for people that are doing admissions, how important that is to ask those non-medical questions to identify barriers to coming into the hospice program or into palliative care, starting with those just informational visits, even before the admission visit.
You mentioned that's the theme from the National Healthcare Decision State. It always seems too early until it's too late. And that's very much. But we really like the whole idea. We agree with everybody that starts with hello. And Dr. Ira Byock really gets to what matters most. And that's where this all needs to really take to. So.
We like the idea of the parish nurse as well. With Fairview, we've trained several parish nurses. We're associated with 70 different faith communities around the area, and bringing this game out to them would be great if it's financially feasible, because they don't have a large budget for games to incorporate that. But it is a really good resource for them, and it really does start earlier. If we can make that conversation an early conversation and have people be comfortable with it, it's going to make our job a lot easier once they get to us in the clinics, in the emergency room, in the hospice at end of life. And we need to revisit this a lot more frequently. It's not one and done. Thank goodness I filled out this thing. I'm going to shove it in the drawer. I'm not going to look at it again. Well, most of it hits us, and it's been 20 years since they've pulled that thing out of the drawer, and people don't even know that they had one. Or the person that they named as a decision maker is dead or has dementia themselves, and nobody else knows what they wanted. So we really need to make sure that we're constantly doing this, an ongoing conversation. It's not one and done, and thank goodness it's done.
A couple more here, right? Oh, you be the one.
Hi, we talked about family and patient support groups, and how this would be a really good way we could use it as an icebreaker, or we could just use it to format those types of groups. That was the one thing that we had that was different.
Great. Last word? Is that right? Okay.
We'd wanted to go first and get it out of the way, and we ended up being last. Now, it's a little more abstract, but related with just kind of everything we've done and with the discussion of the multi-beneficence and things, I suppose maybe the reprioritization of communication. We were kind of thinking a little bit about the fact, if you trace it back to the Latin, there's a link. It's not the same word, but there's a link between the word for communication and the word for community. And, you know, until you learn to communicate with another, it's when you communicate with somebody that you go from being strangers to being a community. And maybe more than anything else, same with when we're married, same with when we're in friends groups, you know, even at the end of life, maybe what we need, even more than the care, even if we can't get the care that we want to receive, to at least know that someone heard us, and to at least know that we're not alone, and that there is a community that is around us, can be very impactful.
You.
What a great way great. To end it.
Round of applause.
So guys, I really appreciate your time. We talked about psychological safety. We played a game and got a little bit about why a game could be useful. talked about multi-beneficence, and I can't wrap it up any better than was just stated, and I hope you all now have some tools that can help you meet your goal, which we all have, of the patient and family-centered care. So thank you very much for being here, and hope you have a great symposium. Thank you.